afternoon to one and all present here. I'd like to welcome you all to the Knowledge Leadership Forum lecture. I now invite Parmesh from 5th year BBA LLB to deliver the welcome address.
A very good afternoon, one and all present here. My name is Parmesh. I'm from the final year BBA LLB branch. It is indeed my honor and privilege welcoming the guest of honor for this evening, Shri C.S. Vaidyanathan sir, Senior Advocate, Supreme Court for this lecture. I'd like to welcome Honorable Vice Chancellor, Dr. S. Vaidyasubramaniam, the Dean School of Law, Shastra Deemed University, Dr. P. Ravishekar Raju, faculty members, non-teaching staffs, and my dear friends. It is a moment of great privilege and honor for me to stand here to extend a heartfelt welcome to all of you to the Knowledge Leadership Forum lecture organized by Shastra Deemed University. We have amongst us Shri C.S. Vaidyanathan sir, Senior Advocate, Supreme Court, to deliver the lecture. The reminiscence of his legacy has always been a matter of pride for all the students of this country. Shri Vaidyanathan was unable to get the lawyer degree after completing the law at the age of 19 and a half because the minimum age required was 21. He then pursued his master's degree in social work and law. He then joined the legal profession in the year 1974. He later shifted to Delhi in 1979 with Shri K.K. Venugopal, who is currently the Attorney General of India, and became an advocate on record in Supreme Court in 1979. In 1992, he was designated as the senior advocate. In the initial stage of his career, he was practicing as the additional Solicitor General of India and later practiced as the private senior counsel. A true inspiration for every one of us here and in fact for every law aspirant of this country. Some of the landmark cases he represented would include cases relating to abolition of mandatory death penalty, right to education, reservation, nature of federal jurisdiction, banning of lottery, etc., which have been decisive judgments under constitutional law. In addition, is also the counsel representing the deity in the Janmabhoomi Babri Masjid land dispute case. His famous news article, Hindu, by name The Gown and the Bench, explicitly expounds the role of committee for designation of senior advocate for ensuring transparency in the process of elevation to the Supreme Court and the High Court. Apart from the professional associations, Shri C.S. Vaidyanathan also has interest in music and dance and reveals his association with institutions propagating music, dance, education, such as Gandharva Mahavidyalaya, Bharatiya Vidya Bhavan, respectively. Today, Shri C.S. Vaidyanathan would be delivering the lecture over the title, Conscience of Counsel. Often, lawyers and other legal practitioners are faced with conflicting interests from their clients they represent, society at large, and from their own personal interests. Legal ethics are therefore important in helping a lawyer to navigate and to bring a balance between the personal ethics and for the greatest good for the society. I know we all are very eager to listen to him, and let us enjoy and learn the most. Thank you.
I'd now like to invite our respected Dean School of Law to present the memento to the Chief Guest. Thank you, sir. I'd now like to invite our Chief Guest to address the students.
Okay. No, for the time being, for just an introduction. Friends, brightens my day to see so many young faces, to be in the midst of all of you. That's energizing, and it inspires me to learn more. And what is more, I find that there are a lot more women here than men. That's even more interesting, and it's I'm so glad to see that there are so many of you who want to become part of the legal system, the judicial system, and to reach the legal services to the people of this country. Whenever I go to any university or to any campus, you know, I really feel that the interaction with all the young, bright future lawyers, you know, it charges me, it recharges me. And there is normally every lawyer is a student throughout his life. Every lawyer learns new things whenever you take up a new case. And today the subjects are so wide and varied that you have necessary to learn a number of new things. Like if you take up intellectual property, patents, you have to learn the technology. So for me, it's a learning experience every day. And when I come to a campus like this, it's a greater learning experience, because I normally do not deliver a talk. And I had made that clear to your Vice Chancellor also when he had, when we were interacting. And I said that I want more of interaction, and therefore it is more a conversation that I want. I want your reaction. I want your reaction to help me, and if I can be of any help in any manner in clarifying your thoughts, I'll use this opportunity. I was just talking to a person who has spent a lot of time on Sanskrit education, and I was asking him, what was the system of education 250 years ago? So in my interaction with your Vice Chancellor and Professor Chamakrishna Sastri, they were telling me that before Macaulay introduced this system of education in this country, we had more than a lack of schools where the education was mainly in Sanskrit. And he was saying that the examination was by persons who were learned and also persons who were from the members of the public. And the learning was very focused, intense, on one particular text for a period of time, 2 or 3 months, and thereafter, subsequently, another text will be taken. That was a very interesting thing that I was learning. If we think back, what was the kind of system of transport, communication, education, health that we had 200, 250 years ago? I think each one of us will have to reflect and see. I don't know how many of you have traveled in this beautiful area. You are living in a piece of land which is so close to the Kaveri water. You know, culture evolved, the civilization evolved in the deltas throughout the world. And you are living in the heart of this southern country where civilization has deep roots. I think you need to, as part of your curriculum, I hope you do travel to the various villages, see the local artisans, the temples, and the kind of life that people live in these, the agraharams and the places where other communities live. I think it's important. And reflect on what was the means of access to them. You didn't have the bridges, so you had to cross the river through the boat. 200-250 years ago, you didn't have these speedy means of transportation, neither bus, car, or train. Forget air. In fact, the other day, when I was during the course of the Ayodhya hearing, I was telling them, when you read those travelogues of 500 years ago, you have to get on to the time machine, go back 5 centuries, 6 centuries. And if you go on a pilgrimage to places like these, those days, even in my younger days, to undertake a Kashiyatra means one never knows whether one will come back, that particularly in the generation prior to mine, prior to all of us. So it was in the case of Sabarimala or most of the other places. But there are people who have traveled. You have travelogues written by Fa Hian, Huan Sang, the Chinese travelers who have come here, the travelers from the Western countries, travelers within India. You have Srimant Sankaradeva from Assam, who lived to be 112. And he had traveled, amongst other places, to Ayodhya, Puri. He spent 12 years on this pilgrimage. Now, these are the kind of things. So how did they travel 500 years ago? This is the matter. So I was telling the court, if you look at this, so why did they go, of all places, to Kashi, to Ayodhya? It was of some significance, some importance. Otherwise, why would anyone undertake that kind of a arduous pilgrimage? Some value, some significance, Puri. So we have to look back and see, in the last 100, 200 years, this entire system of education has changed from education for life to education for living. I think we need to partly go back to the system where the education is for life, not as a means of getting a qualification for livelihood. I think it's not easy to accept this in a competitive world today. All of you go through a system of competitive selection, even for admission into the university. If you do that and spend a lot of time, money, and effort, and when you come out of this, then it is difficult to think and say that isn't it just a means for earning a livelihood? That's a question that logically will be asked. Yes, it is, partly. But that can't be the only object. Similarly, if you look at our system of medicine, health, etc., all these allopathic medicines, the modern medicines, which is the prime focus today in health services, health administration, these are all of fairly recent origin. So did we not in our society, or even other societies in other countries, have some kind of medication, health services? I think we have to look at that. Now I come to the, come closer home. What is the kind of court system or a system for resolution of disputes? The English pride themselves in saying that, look, in the colonies that we administered, we have left behind a very good system of courts based on rule of law. But did we not have some kind of a system earlier? It's for you to reflect. And what was the kind of constitution, what was the kind of overarching law that was prevailing? Today we say the constitution is supreme. The three organs, the legislature, the executive, and the judiciary, they are all answerable to the people. They are all subordinate to the Constitution. They have to subserve the Constitution. They have to advance the objects contemplated by the Constitution. What was that overarching system which was prevalent earlier? Dharma. Even the king was subject to dharma. The people had to obey the king, but the king had to obey the laws of dharma. It was just as today, the three organs are answerable to the people and to the constitution. I think that even the king, the monarch, and we had so many of them because we had so many provinces, so many states, so many kingdoms. They were all answerable to dharma. And it is said that if he did not follow dharma, he could be replaced by the people. So the prevailing system, the overarching system, was dharma. When the British came, the East India companies started setting up courts. They said, in regard to personal laws or wherever the Hindu law or the Mohammedan law was applicable to the people, they would, you apply that. But where these were silent, or there were interstices which had to be filled up, look for justice, equity, and good conscience. This was what was laid down in 1771 and thereafter, the courts, the regulations, 1821, in various presidencies, this was adopted. What is this justice, equity, and good conscience? Was it very different from dharma which was followed? Is it very different from what we today say, rule of law? Or when you test a law, constitutionality of a law, you now say it has to be just, fair, and reasonable. That's the test under Article 14 or Article 19, whenever you test a law for its validity, reasonable. Broadly, these are all what one's common sense would tell you as to what is right, what is right, what is dharma. So the system is not very, very different. But today we have an elaborate system, elaborate codification of the laws. Whether it is needed or not is for all of you, the future lawyers, persons who have a lot of time to practice law, to administer law, to consider. I think we need to simplify, and we shouldn't have this kind of elaborate codification. Without that, we have worked, and without that, it should be possible to work it. Two or three things that I wanted to mention before I want you to interact. One is, I said dharma is supreme, our constitution is supreme, and the principle of justice, equity, and good conscience. When we talk of justice, equity, and good conscience, I think one of the most important things is what the father of the nation said, that the means will have to be right. Very often, we find that the end sought to be achieved by the executive may be right, but the means by which it is achieved or it is sought to be achieved may not perhaps accord with your sense of justice, your sense of equity, your sense of good conscience. As persons who are trained in law, who are going to practice law, one of the first things that I would request you all to bear in mind is that never accept anything as given. Question everything. Even if people cry from the rooftops and say that the ends are right, ask the question. First, whether the end is right, you may not agree with it. Second, is the means adopted for achieving that end right? This is a very, very important question. And I am saying this because the legislature and the executive are vested with great powers. In India, the Constitution vests the power of the supreme watchdog in the judiciary. And you and I, as persons trained in law, are part of this institution of judiciary. We are part of this institution which is the most important watchdog in a democracy. Watchdog for the purpose of ensuring constitution prevails, dharma prevails, rule of law prevails, the means adopted are right and the ends achieved are right. Therefore, as persons who are part of this system of judiciary, as part of the system of persons who are practicing law, trained in law, we need to be ever vigilant. Ask ourselves this question. Never, ever accept anything as given. Ask the question and ask your conscience, does the means adopted, does the law enacted, does the executive action adopted pass this test of common sense? What your mind says is right. That's the first thing. If your common sense says, no, there is something wrong, it doesn't gel with my idea of what is just, fair and right, then there must be something wrong. You please examine. Then look at the constitutionality of that action. Constitutionality of that legislation. That's very important. I am saying this today because we had a time during emergency when judiciary failed. A large part of the judiciary failed. There were some who stood by the side of dharma. We have today a situation where there are failures which are noticeable in judiciary. I perceive failures in the judiciary. We have to be vigilant. But the striking contrast between emergency and now is the bar was more than vigilant during emergency. The bar was willing to fight even on the streets if need be. There were people who went to jail. Today, I get the feeling that the bar is not willing to point out the failures of the institution. And there are failures in the institution. Take it. Not everything is right. Yes, there is a large part which is good. But if there are mistakes happening, we must point out. If you see a blaring headline that the accused is not cooperating and therefore he needs to be in custody, it shocks my conscience. Article 20 doesn't say that the accused will have to confess. I do not understand how anybody can make this kind of an argument and therefore somebody needs to be in jail because the accused is not cooperating. And why are we not shocked? We should be shocked. The other watchdog the media. We had abject failure during the emergency of the media, barring Indian Express statesmen and a few others. Today we have a similar system. Most of the media, I am not saying everything is wrong, but we as lawyers are trained to be watchdogs and to pick holes in what is being done. We should not be pro-establishment. I find it difficult to accept that any judge or lawyer can be pro-establishment, because when you go with a writ petition complaining of wrongful action by the state, the judge has to see that, and he should not presume that whatever the state has done is right. Then what is the need for a judiciary? You have to call for the action. And we had, in the not too distant past, even during emergency, we had a very vigilant judiciary. If there was a habeas corpus petition moved, it would be taken up the same day, notice will be issued, and the next day the state had to produce the return, the records, not time of 4 weeks, 6 weeks for them to produce and for the court to examine. For me, as a person who is concerned with rule of law, with the rights of people, it is difficult for me to accept that you can have a system where a petition will not be taken up immediately, will be taken, or when it is taken up, 4 weeks' time will be given to the state to justify their action. These are things that trouble me today, that trouble my conscience today, that need to trouble every right-thinking citizen. I am not saying that everything is wrong, but we are not here as lawyers, as part of the institution of judiciary, to be applauding the establishment. We have to be critical of the establishment. Why do we have to be critical of the establishment? Because that is part of the role, the watchdog. Part of the role of a watchdog. That is what we should train ourselves to be. As individuals, we may have our opinions, but as lawyers, I think this is a very, very important role. I want to say this today because a feeling is creeping in the large section of the bar that we have to go along with whatever is happening and we should not question. That to me, as a lawyer with a conscience, is unacceptable. I find it difficult to say there may be several good things that are taking place, but if there is something wrong, we are there to point it out and set it right. And that is the first role of any person trained in law. We have to uphold the dharma. That is our duty as students of law, as lawyers. That is our duty. Kindly keep this in mind. You have a long future ahead of you. I am not here to deliver a talk. I am not going to speak about anything else. I would be very, very happy to interact with all of you. Please ask me questions. Please debate. And never fear. See, I was reading some of the books. On Nyaya Sastra, Tarka Sastra. The very civilized, see, even the existence of God, nobody had any hesitation in raising questions and answering them. You raise the question as to the existence of God and you say, you answer it. A very civilized debate. The other day the Prime Minister was saying that we should have very civilized debate. This country should accommodate divergent views and there should be civilized debate. But why are people shirking away from that? And what passes for debate in the media is not civilized debate. As students, you must have divergent opinion. I am sure there is divergent opinion, and you must discuss it in a civilized manner. Not everyone will agree with the view that you have. There will be different perception. There has to be. That is the indicia of every thinking person. We have to differ. We may not agree in respect of everything. But our goal, common goal, will have to be there. We have to keep this. Like, for example, I take, there is a hue and cry today that the rate of growth, GDP, has fallen. I ask myself this question. We are talking of sustainable development in the context of environment. When we talk of sustainable development, that means we have to have generational equity. We have to conserve the resources, the minerals, various other resources. We can't use every, mine every mineral. One of the industries said what we are mining is hardly 1-2% of the mineral wealth of this country. Even that is a huge one. We are not here. Our children, our grandchildren, our great-grandchildren are going to come. They need to sustain themselves also. If we can't exhaust all the mineral resources in one generation or two generations, and if we take away even 2% every year in one generation, we'll be taking out almost half of it. That is not what is intended. For a sustainable development, that can't be the basis. I'm just giving one indication. And we are, okay, now take the other in regard to means of communication and transportation. When we look at designing the urban areas for the future, we are talking in terms of self-sustaining communities where the commute by a person for work can be by walk or by cycle or by some common means of transportation, not necessarily by cars. What happens? The number of cars sold will definitely be lower. In terms of GDP, the rate will fall if you have such close-knit communities, and if the total number of cars which are sold are less, you have to find other means. Therefore, I mean, this is a point of view. Not all of you may agree. I am saying there has to be some balancing. Therefore, when there is a hue and cry that GDP has fallen, don't accept it at face value. Ask yourself this question. Is there a way? Is there a reason for this? Maybe if the means of public transportation improve, the number of the sales of cars will go down. It has to. We have to provide better means of transportation so that the number of cars, the sale, goes down. I'm just giving one example. There are so many other things. I am saying this because our growth is not to be measured simply in terms of GDP. It has to be in terms of the value of life, happiness. That's the means. That's how we should measure. Today, we have adopted this kind of measurement of our development only in terms of the rate of growth of GDP. I think we need to look back and see how in the past people have achieved happiness even though. There is one other aspect that I want to mention. Which is a combination of wealth and law. Three, four centuries ago, we had mostly a system of joint family. The kind of unitary families that we have today was virtually non-existent. There was security in the family. There could have been some areas which were of concern in regard to the rights of women in the family. That's a matter which may be a corruption during the medieval time. But there were two principal centers in which the generation of wealth, the generation of capital was focused. One is the family as a unit. The second is the religious and charitable endowments. The business families which were generating income, engaged in business generating income, sharing their wealth among the family. The other was the centers of learning, centers of culture, centers of spirituality, the religious and charitable endowments. And there were a lot of endowments for these. And these were well utilized for the purpose of education, health, spiritual development, and culture. Today, unfortunately, they have all gone into disuse. We need to look at this. Today, it is not easy to revive or go back to the joint family system. That's not workable. But at least the religious and charitable endowments need to be focused on and revive them and use them in a most profitable manner, because they were the centers in most of the village communities, the centers of learning, centers for providing shelter, centers for providing facilities for health, centers for culture. I think we need to focus on that. I want to leave these thoughts with you, and I want you to raise questions on various other aspects. Thank you very much. Thank you for the opportunity.
Sir, my name is Ramanujam, second year BLLB. Sir, when you told that Dharma is supreme in the world, sir, I have a question related to professional ethics. When a client, in a hypothetical situation, or mostly in reality, when he admits to guilt on some fault, we are bound by attorney-client privilege. We are not supposed to break that thing. But if we break that thing, we get into the wrong part of Dharma. If we don't break it, then the nation gets one more offender. And the nation gets into the wrong path of Dharma. So here's where my question lies, sir. Should we be a good advocate at that situation and to follow our own Dharma, or should we follow the worldly Dharma and let the guilty be punished for the 100% justice to be served to the maximum? Thank you, sir.
Who are we to judge whether a person is guilty? If you have seen somebody committing an offense, then it is different. But if somebody is accused of an offense, he is presumed to be not guilty till it is proved, right?
Yes, sir.
So that's a question. I mean, unless you have material to show that for you to be completely satisfied that that person is guilty. Now, if you don't have that material, I don't think you will be committing any wrong if you defend it. And secondly, in our constitutional scheme of things, whether that should be so or not, is not, that's the law today. Every person is presumed to be innocent, and the onus is on the prosecution to prove the guilt. Therefore, can we as lawyers start judging? Will it be the right dharma for us to follow and pronounce him guilty before he is proved guilty in a court of law?
Yes, sir. Exactly, sir. My follow-up question. So the thing here is, sir, when the client, when he himself tells that he is guilty, and when we are completely aware that he has committed such offense and such sort of thing, but to be a good advocate at that sense, we are completely obliged to win that case, obviously. So how to live with that guilt in mind?
No. If your client comes to you and says that I have committed the offense, then you are right. Then it's, I think your conscience then should dictate that perhaps it would not be appropriate for you. Because if he has come and confessed to a crime, you have to make a choice. Because one of our senior most professionals, Mr. Ram Jatnani, he has a different perspective on this. He says that no, you have to defend even such a person. I may not agree. I have slightly different approach in these matters. For example, when in the Bhopal gas leak case, the company came to me to appear on their behalf. I found it difficult to accept that brief for the simple reason that was prima facie to me, it appeared that there was a gas leak and so many persons have been affected. And it would be going against my conscience to defend that company. On the other hand, when Mr. Sarabji, as the Attorney General, wanted me to be part of the team to appear on behalf of the government, I accepted it. This is, of course, each one has a different perspective in regard to these matters. I mean, you will have to make up your mind on that.
Thank you, sir. It was indeed a pleasure.
Sir, good evening, sir. I'm Ram Subramanian, first year BCom LLB. And I wish to ask you this question. How is morality different from legality? In the sense, I take the case of Mr. Ram Jethmalani sir himself. He has appeared for many people who are accused in scams like Harshad Mehta, and even for our former chief minister in disproportionate assets case. In this case, he appears for accused persons who are eventually convicted. Maybe they are accused of that offense. How can a lawyer defend a person who is accused, and how can he live with that guilt? Maybe many of the persons even call him some gangster's lawyer or something. I'm not sure with the exact term. How can a lawyer get out of this, and how is this, morality? That's my question.
See, the Constitution lays down that you have to follow a procedure. A person's liberty can be deprived only by following the procedure established by law. Therefore, anyone who is accused of an offense will have to be tried in a court of law, will have to be convicted on establishment of guilt. The proof has to be by the prosecution, and thereafter the sentence is given. Now, if you have a system where the procedure established by law requires a trial in a court of law, can there be a trial if the accused is not represented by counsel? Can't be. So you need a counsel to represent the accused, because that is the fair procedure which is contemplated by the Constitution. Therefore, you are not doing anything contrary to dharma or even morality by representing the accused. So long as there is no dilemma by his coming and confessing to you that he has committed the offense. Otherwise, the proof has to be by the prosecution. Now, you talked also of morality and law. Morality and law, there are different aspects, because what is immoral need not necessarily be illegal. For example, gambling. Unless it is prohibited by law, it is not illegal. It may appear to you to be immoral. A system of lottery, or take even, say, consumption of tobacco, smoking. There are people who may feel that it is immoral. But COTPA, Cigarettes and Other Tobacco Products Act, says that it is not prohibited. Therefore, it is not illegal. Smoking today is not illegal. But for some people, it may be immoral. Now, your dance bar case, that was the question that arose. The sense of morality, the perception of morality of one person may not necessarily accord with another person's perception of morality. But legality or illegality is not based on perception, it is based on law. So if the law prohibits it, it is illegal. So you have to make this distinction between morality and legality. So what may be immoral in your perception may not necessarily be legal, unless there is a law which prohibits. Today we are governed by a system of law. So you have to make this distinction.
And I have one more question, sir. Regarding this allegations made against the Chief Justice of India, recently a case came up. And why the proceedings were conducted in camera and not made public even to the person who has made the complaint, and how is this legally applicable?
I think this is a very, according to me, a very, very important question. Even the person who is holding the highest office in judiciary, I think, number one, he is answerable. He is answerable to the Constitution, he is answerable to the people. There can't be one law for all the others and another law for the Chief Justice of India. It has to be the same. There has to be transparency. I do not think that anyone can possibly say the institution of judiciary is so fragile that it would shatter or collapse if there is transparency. I refuse to accept an argument that there should not be transparency in this system. And the person who had raised this issue, in my perception, that's my view. There can be different views on this, but my own view is, I think she is entitled to a copy of the report which was prepared by a committee. That's my view.
Thank you very much, sir. It's been a pleasure to speak to you. Thank you.
Good evening, sir. I'm Tejaswini, a fourth year BLLB student. So my question to you is, do you think a lawyer should go beyond the conscience of his own to understand and analyze the conscience of the judges and the other counsels as well to benefit for his own? Do you think it will go against the dharma of his own conscience?
We, as counsel, we are answerable to our conscience, but we are also officers of court. As officers of court, we have to place before the court the correct facts and the correct law. Our duty to the other counsel is only to the extent that we are in an adversarial system. In our country, we practice an adversarial system. Therefore, when we advocate the cause of our client, we know that there is another person who represents the cause of the opposing client. Therefore, our fairness goes to the extent of placing only the correct facts and not misleading the court. Our fairness goes to the extent of placing the correct law and not, if we know, for example, that there is one judgment which we want to rely on, but which has been subsequently overruled or which has been subsequently distinguished. I think we owe a duty to the court to point out that the judgment that I am relying on, that either that I had placed this judgment but I have now found that it is overruled or distinguished. That's the duty that we owe to the court, we owe to ourselves. We owe to our conduct. That is part of our dharma. We should not mislead the court. That's the dharma, to that extent, and not beyond. You have, therefore, you are entitled to make all pleadings, all submissions, which will advance the cause of your client, in a manner in which what you are doing is correct according to facts, correct according to law. And then you will not be doing wrong.
Thank you, sir. I have just one more question for you. Sir, adding significance to the secular aspect to any religion, sir, what do you think and how do you differentiate beliefs and practices from the essential and integral part of a religion? And how do you think this Ayodhya case will contribute towards our understanding to the same, sir?
Sorry, I didn't follow this question.
Sir, my question is, adding secular and the spiritual aspect to any religion, how do you distinguish the essential and integral part of a religion from mere beliefs and practices, sir? And how the Ayodhya case will contribute to the same for our own understanding in this aspect?
See, Ayodhya case is not going into the essential part of the religion. This is being decided more from the point of view of title to your property in terms of over the years, who has had the possession, who has had the title, who has used that property, etc. So, one of the arguments advanced is in regard to divinity attached to the place. Maybe to that extent only there is some amount of spirituality. Now, on the larger issue of essential part of religion, the secular courts, we are not having ecclesiastical courts. We are not having courts which decide on issues of religion. Therefore, our courts have consciously kept away from matters which are essential parts of religion. Therefore, what is the faith of the religion? Now, there can be persons who will question about the Immaculate Conception of Christ. The Darwinians may say that this is all completely unacceptable. This is all fantasy. This is not true. This is not scientific. There can be a view. But our secular courts do not go into the correctness or otherwise of this belief. That's the faith and belief of the people. Equally, we Hindus have several faith and belief in regard to whether it is idol worship or whatever it is. Now, the correctness of this is not to be gone into by the secular courts. Their role is very limited. But there are aspects which may arise. For example, in regard to the, if you take the Free Church case, the Irish Free Church case, 1910, one of the questions that arose was, church is set up, a congregational church, on the basis of the faith and belief of a set of people, a particular faith. If they then want to change, should this property, the parish church, continue to belong to the even 10% of the people who have the original faith, or should it go to 90% of the people who might have changed their system of faith and belief? This is an aspect which has been decided by the secular court. It has been decided in India also in regard to, for example, the Orthodox and Jacobite system. There is a huge split. Some of them believe that the Patriarch of Antioch is the person who is the head of the church. And there is a fairly sizable section of people who believe that it is the Catholicate which has been established in India, which is the head. Now, the factional disputes has been going on for the last, say, 120 years. And it has been taken up by the Travancore courts, the Cochin courts, and thereafter it has seen at least 3 rounds in the Supreme Court. And they have had to adjudicate on this. And the Supreme Court has adjudicated basically on the basis of the rules of the association, the bylaws of the association, bylaws of the church, the congregation which has been. Therefore, that is how this is. But they have not gone into, they have gone only into the temporal aspect, not the spiritual aspect. Only the temporal aspect.
Thank you. Thank you, sir. Good evening, sir. I'm Reshmita G. Sharma. I'm a student of 4th year BCom LLB. So my question is, everything right or wrong has an exception.
Every right or wrong?
Has an exception. So today, when I look at a case, I feel, going by my sense of logic, that it is right. Tomorrow, as I proceed with the case, going by my sense of conscience, I feel it is wrong. So am I being a hypocrite there? How do I contemplate or decide if I'm doing the right thing or the wrong thing by choosing to take up the case?
I think you need to elaborate a little more. How today, I mean, when you say that today you feel it is right and tomorrow it is wrong, that means as the facts emerge?
Yeah.
Okay. Now, it could happen that the facts as brought out during the course of the evidence could point to the guilt of a person. It is possible. You have accepted a brief to defend an accused. The proof is brought by the prosecution to show the guilt of the accused. Do you then give up the brief at that stage?
I do not give up the brief, but in going by my sense of conscience, now I know I'm doing the wrong thing. So am I being a hypocrite there?
No. That's what I'm saying. When you accepted the brief, the guilt had not been brought home. The prosecution is doing its karma of proving the case. You did your karma of defending the accused. So what is the moral dilemma in this? You did your karma of defending the accused, isn't it? Prosecution has proved it. The court, the system, the judiciary, that is the institution which is to balance the interests of the citizens and the state, and that it will convict. So you have done your duty, you have discharged to the best of your ability and satisfied your conscience that, yes, I have, made the prosecution prove it. No, if they have proved it and if the court is willing to accept it, you have done no wrong. I don't think you need to have a moral dilemma at that stage.
Thank you. Good afternoon, sir. I'm Jumana, a second year student. My question is, Magdalene Braden said that a good lawyer knows the law, but a great lawyer knows the judge. What's your take on that, sir?
Every lawyer knows the law, but every?
A good lawyer knows the law, but yeah. A great lawyer knows the judge.
No. I don't think in our value-based system of education or institutional justice, it is acceptable that a great lawyer knows the judge and that he will succeed. I know of a judge and a senior advocate from this part, who was even the Attorney General. They were great friends. They used to meet practically every evening. And they would share a drink. He would appear in the court next morning before him. But the judge was never swayed by the fact that he was spending time in the company of his friend the previous evening. That is the true mark of a great judge. So in the system of INSEP court in England, the barristers, the lawyers, and the judges, they share a drink, they have dinner together, but it never affects their system of administration of justice. So the fact that you know a judge, you are friendly with a judge, that should not affect the system of administration of justice by the judge. So the value is in the greatness of the judge. And no lawyer can claim to be great by being friendly to a judge.
Thank you, sir. Good evening, sir. I'm Samyukta from BCom LLB second year. My doubt is that I would like to take up the case of Ajmal Kasab.
Sorry?
Ajmal Kasab, the terrorist from Mumbai, the lone terrorist, Ajmal Kasab.
Kasab? Yes.
So, sir, I would like to take up that case and say that a lot of lawyers rejected to represent him at that point of time because he was a terrorist and he was found alone. So that means essentially that he is the terrorist. And Ramjet Malani said that any accused cannot be not given representation merely because of what is not proved. So I would like to ask you what your take would be on the people who rejected him.
See, Ajmal Kasab's case, the argument was also on the basis that you could see the video evidence of the person concerned shooting at various innocent persons. This was one of the things which was put forth. So how can you represent such a person? That was a question raised. Now, the person who actually represented him finally in the Supreme Court is a very good friend of mine, very dear friend of mine. And in his perception, and I quite agree with that, there could be several reasons why he did it. Now, that he was a terrorist is a matter which needs to be proved. Yes, the fact that he killed is there. What was his motivation? Therefore, it will make a difference in regard to the conviction and the sentence also. So, as a lawyer, if you are able to show that he was mentally unsound, that's a good defense.
Yes.
That's a perfectly legal defense. You are entitled to take that case. Therefore, yes, there is visual evidence which has been recorded and telecast of that person actually killing various people. But if he was so mentally imbalanced or unsound, and which led to this, maybe it is the law provides such a defense. And as a lawyer, you will not be doing anything contrary to your dharma by advocating that defense, if that is available to you. That's one of the things. Therefore, I do not necessarily share the perception that the lawyer was doing the wrong thing by defending.
Sir, I have another doubt. Some people share the view that a person from the enemy country should not essentially be represented in our country.
When did this concept of nation state come in? When did this concept of boundaries come in? Why? We are all human beings. Why should the boundary be the criterion for determining whether that human being is entitled to be represented in a court of law? He is another human being. I don't think we need to divide the human beings on the basis of boundaries and then say that he is a person who belongs to another country, therefore I won't represent him. That doesn't.
Thank you, sir.
Good evening, sir. My name is Srishti Pandey and I'm from the second year. I believe that people approach the judge and judiciary because we have the ability to look at any case or the facts of the case more objectively, disregarding whatever personal bias we have. But we as students, for the past 18 or 19 years of our life, we have looked at everything with whatever prejudices and superstitions we had. So how would you, with your experience, how would you ask us and guide us to move away from that and look at everything objectively so that our future career as an advocate and in the judiciary is easier or is more correct as to be more objective? How would you guide us, sir?
I think every learning starts with unlearning what may not necessarily be right. So we have to start unlearning some of the things. If you say that there has been some superstition, as you said, put it, we have to unlearn that. And we have to keep an open mind. When we say we welcome wisdom from wherever it comes, that's our belief, isn't it? So we receive that wisdom. Partly what we might have imbibed in the past may not be right. So we question it. And if we question and find that what we have learned, what we have imbibed is not necessarily right, we have to eschew that, discard it, and then move forward. Yet.
Very good evening, sir. My name is Anirudh. I'm from second year BCom LLB. So my question is, Dharma has become a matter of subjective opinions. Like, each person has their own view of what Dharma is. So keeping that in mind, and the current laws which have become very dynamic, so how do you think a lawyer should, you know, cope up with the current change in laws and his own subjective dharma?
I do not necessarily share your view that the perception of dharma changes from person to person. There are shared perceptions. There could be minor differences. But today our dharma is the constitution. It is the supreme law. There are values which are there. But even in regard to interpretation of constitution, there are differences. That is why we have a constitutional court and people take diverse points of view and present it. So what I say may be just, fair and reasonable may not be accepted by the other person as just, fair and reasonable. But that doesn't mean that there is a sharp difference in regard to perceptions of dharma. I think the constitution today is the law, is the supreme law. There are other laws in which have been laid down, and that guide, there could be minor variations in the interpretation, but broadly, I think 99% of it is the shared perception of all.
Good evening, sir. I'm Shiva from second year BA LLB. In the Puttaswamy judgment, Justice Chandrachud said constitutional morality is the only morality that should prevail in the country. Sir, what would be your take on it, sir?
From the court's perspective, that is a morality.
Yes, sir.
From when the court is judging any executive action, when the court is judging any legislation, that is a morality by which the action is tested. But in our society, sometimes we have a different sense of morality. But if you want to visit somebody with a penalty, if you want to visit somebody with a consequence of any action which you perceive to be immoral, but which is not declared by law to be illegal, then what Justice Chandrachud says, it is the constitutional morality which will have to prevail. Therefore, the fact that 90% of the people may think that something is immoral may not necessarily be immoral. Now, you take the case of LTGP. Yes. Now, there could be a perception in some set of people that there is something, it's unnatural, yes, it is immoral. That it is testing that one has to see whether the right of that person is in any manner affected by the laws of the country, and whether, if it is affected, whether that law stands the test of rationality, stands the test of just fair and reasonable procedure, just fair and reasonable restriction. It is from that perspective that he is looking at. Court is not the torchbearer of the morality of the people. That is, if the morality of the people is this, and if that is reflected in the will of the people, which is then carried into the legislative wisdom and converts itself into a legislation, then the court will have to use that for the purpose of judging the standard. But if the court says, no, you can't impose your morality on a set of people who have a right to be different, then they say that it is unconstitutional.
Yes. That's it. Sir, a follow-up question. From a lawyer's perspective, should a lawyer follow his own notions of morality, or should he be bound by constitutional morality?
We have to be, as an officer of court, we are bound by constitutional morality. We have to be. Therefore, you, in your personal life, you may follow your sense of morality. But in regard to the court system of courts, in regard to the conduct in the courts, in regard to representing people in courts, you have to follow the system of constitutional morality.
Thank you, sir.
I'd now like to invite Himanshu from fourth year BBLLB to deliver. Okay. Are there any more questions? Okay. Okay, so I think there were people who were interested in.
Huh? Yeah, no problem.
Thank you for your time, sir. I'm Kaushik, a fourth year BALLB. I have a doubt, like, I conceive the idea of dharma as to perform one's own duty. So take the instances, the cases, in which a person commits an offense which actually have an impact on the bodily integrity of a woman. So in such cases, that creates a fuss. So we can come across instances where the bench takes a decision that we will not represent this accused in this particular case. So in this particular instance, as an advocate, I have a duty to accept the brief which is coming before me. That's the dharma towards the client. Whereas towards the court, I have a dharma that I shouldn't mislead the court. So there's a different dharma for different roles. So I stand confused here on what should be the path I should choose. So could you just answer me on this particular?
Yeah. See, your question is premised on the fact that you have been asked by the court to represent the person.
No, the point here is, when I play different roles, there are different dharmas which are interrelated to those roles.
No, therefore, what I want to know is, have you taken on the brief, or have you been asked by the court to act as the counsel for the accused?
I believe, as a professional ethics, we shouldn't deny any brief which is coming towards us.
Correct.
Setting aside our own values, it is the duty of an advocate to present before the court an accused person's brief. So, I have a duty towards my client to represent the case. Whereas I have a duty towards the court to not to mislead in case that the accused person is actually an offender. So in that case, I have different dharmas to different roles. So there's an inherent confusion on what path I should choose to actually uphold dharma.
See, in our system of laws, if are you going by the confession of guilt of the accused to his own counsel to replace the proof by the prosecution. Our system requires the proof of guilt by the prosecution in a court of law. Now, if the accused confesses, accused is interrogated, when before the accused is produced, his statement would have been recorded. In his statement to the police, if he has confessed, that itself is not sufficient. The confession will have to be to the court, because even an admission of guilt before the police under the Criminal Procedure Code does not dispense with the requirement of proof of guilt by the police. However, if the accused wants to confess to his guilt before the court, there is a procedure for that. If that is done, then that is good enough for the court to convict. Now, what you are saying is, the accused comes to you when you are representing him and he tells you that, yes, he has committed the crime. Therefore, a confession before the police is not treated as good enough under the law. A confession before you will not dispense with the requirement of proof of guilt. It is only the confession to the court. If he confesses to you, you can ask him, therefore, do you want to confess to the guilt before the court, before the magistrate? If he does that, then that is good enough. If he says, no, I don't want to, then he is entitled to a trial under our system of law. So then you may have a moral dilemma, but legally he is entitled to be represented in a court of law, because the requirement of law is that the guilt will have to be proved by the prosecution in a court of law. Therefore, I don't think you will be doing anything wrong in that process. But you can discharge your moral dilemma. You can solve that by asking him, you are telling me that you have committed it, but you have not said that to the police. You have not told the court. Do you want to go and tell the court? Since you are telling me this, do you want to tell the court this? You ask yourself. And if you want to tell the court, you then facilitate him to make that confession.
Thank you.
Good afternoon, sir. I'm Madhu Mehta from second year BBLB. Sir, I recently came across a statement that said, if any action which is an offense punishable only by a fine, means that action is legal for the rich. I'd like to know your opinion on this statement.
If it is punishable
only by an offense, means
no,
that
by fine.
By a fine.
Yes. Then is it?
It means that it is legal for the rich.
No. I would say it is legal by. There are cases and cases. Like for example, the law in regard to what has been now imposed as a statutory duty on corporate social responsibility, CSR. What it says is that a part of your profits you must use for the purpose of doing some good social cause by way of corporate social responsibility. Now, the failure to do that, there was a proposal, or it was actually legislatively acted upon to treat it as penal. Not just a fine, but to make it punishable, treat it as an offense. There was a hue and cry. Now look at this kind of a situation. You are legislating on somebody, instead of being making a voluntary contribution to a social cause, you are mandated to do that. On his failure to do that, you are making it an offense. Now, is this a kind of offense? What, according to you, will be, it is a violation of law, but does it accord with your sense of justice, equity, and good conscience to treat it as an offense? This is the question that one has to ask. So it is not as if the rich can pay a fine and get away from it. Why certain failures to comply with the law are not necessarily treated as penal, subject to penal consequences by way of sentence, punishment, conviction, etc. Is that this is not of that kind where our social contract with the state requires it to be treated as penal. See, when the whole system of political theory and governance is on the basis that we enter into a social contract, and we want a set of people to govern us for looking after our security, our law and order, etc. If it is an action which will pose a threat to my life, living, then it stands on a different footing. But if it is an action which will not pose such a threat, then you don't classify in that category of an offense. So I don't think you need to put it in that category.
Understand. Thank you, sir.
Good evening, sir. I'm Sandhya from BBLLB second year. Sir, when a person becomes a successful lawyer, should there be any norm or a guide or a standard that he should follow while charging a fee so that it's both professionally and ethically acceptable?
It's a question which has been raised. You know, till almost 1980, in the Supreme Court, there was a kind of an informal understanding in regard to the level of fees. And you'll be shocked to know the amount that was then treated as the fair fee. It was 1,040 for appearance for an admission hearing, a miscellaneous hearing. And 1,680 for a final hearing. This was almost a norm which was accepted and followed by all senior counsel till 79-80. Then people started charging different amounts. There was an issue raised in the Supreme Court Bar Association as to whether it is right for senior counsel to depart from this. Then it was proposed that there should be a voluntary rule by which, yes, 1040 and 1680 might be very, very low by today's cost of living standards, etc. We will make it 5,000 and 10,000. That was also followed for about 4 or 5 years. Then today, it is what the market can afford. Therefore, it is totally free enterprise. Law was a learned profession, so was medicine. Law was a learned profession, and in your gown, there will be at the back a pocket. And what the client could afford, he will put in that pocket, in the gown. And nobody will ask what is there, and then you will simply appear. Today, the standards have changed. People say that my time is money. Therefore, if I can command so much per hour or so much per appearance, and if a corporate entity which makes substantial amounts by way of profits can afford to pay that, why should I not? But therefore, the state has stepped in and said, for example, the tax which was 35.7% on people who are earning more than 5 crores, it has become 42.7. Therefore, the state is recovering in another way almost half of whatever a professional is charging. So he is treated, the legal professional is also treated virtually as a business person, and the tax is being collected on that basis. So in a way, you are no longer treating yourself as a true professional, and we are engaged in business in that sense. But a business which is regulated, that's the real standard. See, in the olden days, when the Varnashrama Dharma was being followed, learning was never priced. Sharing of learning was never priced. Nobody will demand a fee for parting with that. And the Brahmins used to seek alms for the day and consume. They never held back anything even for the next day. That is no longer prevalent. Values have changed. Today, Tyagaraja never claimed copyright for his song. Today, a composer or a singer claims copyright. He demands a fee. There are people who argue, can you have a patent in regard to life-saving medicine? This is a question which is a matter for moral debate. There can be different perception. But intellectual property right today is a valuable property right which is recognized the world over. But should there be a reasonable cap on the royalty, on the license fee? That is a matter. But that it is a valuable property. But in the olden days, nobody claimed any patent right. Whether it was Charaka or whoever it was, if you discovered some property in a moolige in some medicinal plan, you didn't claim an intellectual property. Therefore, values have changed, and so in our profession also. You have to move with the times.
Thank you, sir. My question is, after years of experience, an advocate becomes a judge. So, all the years, he would have argued on one favor. So how do we know, how are we assured that the judge who's eventually an advocate is not biased?
It's a very important question from the point of view of our profession. Firstly, as lawyers, we do not identify ourselves with client. There has to be a disconnect. We plead a client's case. Number one, we don't identify ourselves with that case. So therefore, we should also not be bothered about the result. We do our duty. Karmanyeva adhikarase. You do it. Then you don't look at what the result is. The result is there is an independent judge who delivers the justice. That's the system. Therefore, the basic premise on which you have asked the question, that because you have been appearing in a particular line of cases, you will have a biased point of view, is premised on a lawyer identifying himself with that particular approach. I don't think that is necessarily right. As a true professional, you should not, number one. Number two, as a professional, we appear sometimes for the prosecution, sometimes for the accused in criminal cases, sometimes for the plaintiff, sometimes for the defendant, sometimes for the state or the for in a tax matter, sometimes for the assessee. So we have different roles and we should train ourselves to play that different role. But your question is relevant, for example, from the point of view of a person who has been, like, say, a standing counsel for income tax or a government pleader for 20 years. Will he have that bias when he sits in court to decide in favor of the revenue if he has been a standing counsel? Or if he has been appearing only for government, will he be anti-petitioner, as it were, again, in writ actions against the government? By and large, the experience has been the judges are able to differentiate the role which they have been performing earlier as lawyers. And when they assume this guard, I think the seat itself has that impact on them, on a person who occupies that office. I think broadly, my experience in my life has been that most persons are able to look at it dispassionately, except, I mean, there are a few instances of persons who have a pronounced bias, but that is that's the exception rather than the rule. The rule is that they are independent.
My question is, I have to do something which is as per my dharma, but the means for me to achieve the same is immoral as per me. So do I give up my morality in order to do what is right, the end, or do I just not do it at all?
I think the means are very, very important. The fact that I am sure if the end is right, there must be a right way of achieving that end. There can't be, you should not follow the wrong means to achieve a right end.
Maybe there are right means, but to me it feels immoral, sir. So do I still go about doing it?
No, if you feel that it is immoral, then I think, then I have no doubt that even the end will be wrong. If the means to achieve is immoral according to you, then I think your sense of justice should tell you that even the end will be wrong. It can't be. You give me one example of where the end is right, but the means of achieving it is immoral. For me, it is difficult to conceive if the end is right, that there can't be a moral way of achieving it. Okay. You give me an example. There has to be. Because then, otherwise, there is an inconsistency. I mean, inherent inconsistency in that.
Something very simple, sir. Like, your dharma is to follow your parents, what your parents say or something like that.
Yeah.
But most of the time, our parents' opinions or our parents' viewpoints on certain things do not come in line with what we have. So for me, what is moral may seem immoral to my parents. So do I still go about listening to them, or do I go about in my own way?
No, this is not, I would say, immoral. What you have described as immoral is not really immoral in that sense. This is a difference in perception. What you perceive to be right is not perceived to be right by your parents. That's the question. This is a matter on which you have to remove the misperception, misconception that it is a wrong in the mind of the parents, and you should be able to achieve. If you are not, I mean, the persuasion has to, then if you are satisfied that what you are doing is right, you must try to persuade the persons who are different from you that no, what you are doing is morally right. And even if they are not convinced, if you are satisfied that what you are doing is right, I think you should pursue that. It might cause discomfort, to some extent unhappiness, temporarily. But I am sure the persons who differ from you, what you are following, your conscience says is right, I am sure they will come round to your point of view later, after some time.
Thank you, sir.
Good evening, sir. I am Danya from second year BA LLB. You had mentioned that there are certain failures in our judicial system and that the bar should dwell upon certain issues. Now, my question is, what, according to you, is one such failure that the bar can and should immediately act upon?
I think this is a... See, you must be, as a student of law, you must be able to tell me, have you not perceived anything wrong?
I have, but... I am not very clear. I mean, I am not able to be very firm with deciding whether it is actually a failure or not.
I'll give you one or two illustrations. When the judge says, custodial interrogation is necessary. To me, if we have Article 20, the right of silence in the accused, if you have Miranda, which is celebrated American case, the right of silence of accused. Now, what is this custodial interrogation? Is it third-degree method of extracting a confession? To me, an order from a court which says that custodial interrogation is needed and therefore the man should be sent to custody is not something which is acceptable. As I said earlier, when somebody argues, case is entirely on documentary evidence. All the documents have been collected. The man has been free for the last 5 years, and he has not tampered with any witnesses or evidence. But if he is to be sent to jail today, to me, doesn't appear to be just. But these are things in which you have to, when I said protest, it is not in regard to these things. But when I say protest, it is in regard to some other thing. If you have persons, like for example, one judge yesterday said, who is this person who doesn't comply with this order, does he not think that he is part of India's judicial system, part of India? He is not the judge part of, is he not an Indian? No, this is a kind of statement which comes from somebody in from the highest court of the land in respect of another judge of the superior judiciary who is not subordinate to him. The Supreme Court doesn't have any supervisory jurisdiction over a High Court judge. You may say that judgment is wrong, but you are not to comment on a judge in this manner. I think that is wrong. Nobody can be arrogant enough to make that kind of comment. That is complete, according to me, constitutionally, it is not right. The High Court judges are not subordinate to Supreme Court judges. The system provides for an appeal to the Supreme Court. You may say that the judgment is wrong, but nobody has a right to pass this kind of comments.
How do you think that the bar can take an action?
I think this is a matter where the bar should certainly protest. You can't categorize, chastise a High Court judge in this manner. That's not, people will think twice, thrice before becoming a High Court judge if this is the kind of comments that are made about High Court judges. I think he might have made a bona fide mistake. He might have made a mistake. You are entitled to correct that you have the power to correct the mistake, but not to chastise him in this manner. That I don't think is right.
So with your permission, I'll ask the last question.
Yes.
Okay. 2 years back, actually, we had Mr. Justice Sanjay Kishan Kaul as the Chief Justice of the Madras High Court come and address the audience for a similar event like this. In fact, after his speech, he was so generous to accommodate a lot of questions. And for those who were here, I think some of you were here as students as well. There was a long queue. And today also we saw a long queue when you were addressing the audience. But what still remained fresh in our minds was Justice Kaul later said, you know, after my speech, actually I had to undertake an examination at Shastra Law School where students, you know, confronted me with a lot of questions. And he really did enjoy answering those questions. And I'm sure you also had the same feeling taking questions from the students. My question is very simple, just speaking from what you had said on, there are actions that are immoral but maybe legal. And the Constitution, which of course is very supreme, was a recent addition to the way of life. And those were the days you said even the kings upheld dharma, and the conviction was that, you know, the king can do no wrong. And hence, there was no constitution or written law, and the society was functioning in a very dharmic way. And of course, there was, you know, marginal deviance, which was ignored. But later, you know, after all this constitution and all of this, that today, marginal deviance is
celebrated or maybe intentionally picked and tested for its legality using constitution, when actually social behavior predated constitution and we did not have any problems with the majority of the social behavior. Now my question is, if this is allowed, not that I am against it, but if we continue to do that and marginal deviance in a way is responsible for erosion of social values, just as, you know, constitution has a basic structure, doesn't society also require a basic structure that should not be compromised? Then, if your answer is yes to that, what should be the role of judiciary in ensuring that the basic structure of the society is also equally maintained?
See, we have three organs. The sense of morality of the people is conveyed through the members in the legislature and they act upon it. But the morality of the majority is not necessarily the morality in the sense of the Constitution. A large section of people may have a particular viewpoint. That is why in our system of governance based on constitutional morality, we have checks and balances where the judiciary is the watchdog who checks whether the legislative action or the executive action is right in terms of what the Constitution guarantees. So there, the morality of the majority, if it is sought to be imposed on the minority, there has to be some watchdog, and that watchdog is the court. But the court is also guided by the written law. It is not any whim or fancy of a judge who is sitting, but he has to follow the text of the law. Sometimes what happens is there are interstices in the text which are sought to be filled in by the interpreters of the Constitution, that is the court. And they say that this is how this text will have to be read, and therefore the text mandates X, Y, Z. And the law which has been made by the legislature fails this text, and therefore it is struck down. Now, the value of the system is, because one judge says this, it doesn't become final. You have an appeal. You have then the Supreme Court. And in the Supreme Court, there can be larger benches. Therefore, sometimes, as it has happened, when whether it was Liversidge versus Anderson or ADM Jabalpur, the judges by majority of the day may take a particular view, but the dissent in that later on is the voice which then gains ascendance and becomes a law. This is our constitutional scheme. Therefore, there is a machinery, and the judges, although they are supposed to be completely divorced from what is happening, they are not so fully divorced. Therefore, they know what is the sense of the people also, and they do take that into account. And over a period of time, the system has ensured that there is a peaceful transition. And that is how we have to necessarily bank on that peaceful transition. Thank you. I have had a very beautiful learning experience. Thank you all.
Thank you, sir. I'd now like to invite Himanshu from fourth year BBA LLB to deliver the vote of thanks.
As rightly quoted by Albert Schweitzer, at times our own light goes out and is rekindled by a spark from another person. Each of us has cause to think with deep gratitude of those who have lightened the flame within us. Good evening, everybody. This is S. Himanshu Parmar, a student of fourth year BBA LLB honors, here to deliver the vote of thanks. Firstly, I would like to thank the Honorable Chief Guest, Shri C.S. Vaidyanathan, Senior Supreme Court Advocate, for his insightful lecture and a very illuminating interaction on the interesting topic, Conscience of Counsel. The topic assumes importance for students like us when the fear of corruption and dubious practice has not left this noble profession untouched. It is a privilege to hear from our esteemed speaker on how salient ethics is to our profession. Sir's speech essentially teaches us the lesson that even in the most testing of circumstances, we must listen to the voice of Dharma, which will guide us along the right path. As future advocates and budding counsels, we must inculcate in ourselves the practice of listening to our instincts, as it is the surest guide to avoiding the feeling of not having done the right thing. Next, I would like to extend my heartfelt gratitude to the Vice Chancellor, Dr. S. Vaidya Subramaniam, for supporting the law school and organizing such amazing knowledge forum lectures which help hone our skills of upcoming law. I also thank the Registrar, Dr. R. Chandramouli, for his blessings. I take deep pleasure in extending my thanks to the Dean PND, Dr. S. Swaminathan, for his unequivocal support and also for inviting our Honorable Chief Guest. I'd also like to thank the Dean School of Law, Dr. Ravishekhar Raju, for being our pillar of strength. Further, I take immense pleasure in extending my deep gratitude towards the Faculty of School of Law, Sahasra Deemed University, for their undiminishing support towards the success of this deemed. I would also take this opportunity to thank the students for taking active part in this lecture and showing keen interest in learning new things. I would fail in my duty if I do not extend my immense gratitude to the members of the Civil, Maintenance and Electrical Department, without whom this program would have not been a grand success. Last but not the least, I would also like to extend my heartfelt thanks to our friends of the press and print media. Thank you.